Hey guys, welcome back to the channel, guys. How are we, pair guys? Today, guys, we have a live video today, quick. And I want to show you guys how everything started, how the idea was born about Auto Repair Guys and World Mechanics, both of our channels. That's my dad and I, both of us started everything together. And a cool thing about these guys, we didn't know so much about cars before. And I used to go to Google 2007, 2008 and Google about all kinds of stuff because modern cars are way more complicated than old school cars, as you know. They always have new computers, new sensors, something always evolving. So no matter how smart you are, no matter what you do, you never ever know everything. Some people will pretend they do, but don't believe them. So we saw so many videos, guys, so many videos how to fix things. We read so much information on forums, and I was so thankful for those videos that people took their time to make those videos. So I said one day when we get serious about that, we'll start making videos. We'll try to make videos that don't exist anymore. And even if we know that some video won't be watched because it's a rare thing and it might not happen to many people, we'll still make it because we might help 10 people, but hey, it's better than going to the dealer, and the satisfaction about doing it, it's amazing. So let me show you guys how we started now. Everything started with a phone. My wife's phone right here, 3GS. We didn't have the money to get anything expensive, guys, so it started with just the iPhone 3GS. After that, we invested a little bit of money. We got a camera, Sony, okay, which was very inexpensive, but HD camera, good quality, guys. And as you can see, that video now on the wall that we're fixing a bumper, it's even recorded with that thing. It's our most popular video. After that, we invested in a GoPro 3, and our latest one is this Lumix right here. That's what we've been using lately, so we can deliver better quality, guys. Hi, okay, I wanna connect quick here. Okay, let me connect quick to Auto Repair Guys, so that way probably I can see the messages better, because I'm live streaming from my phone right now. Okay, let me switch the camera. Okay, and it's hard for me to read on the phone. We're still learning how to do the live session. So I've been thinking, guys, about something maybe, you know, like having like a session once a week, answering questions and things like that. And if we cannot answer the question, to have a person, you know, like you, to come to the channel and actually, if you know the answer, to help us. Because we learn from one another. It's not like we know everything. That's one thing for sure, guys. And I'm super excited about that new idea. Been thinking about creating a forum on our website, because going through the comments, sometimes I cannot answer comments. I mean, I'm really sorry, you know, trying to, but it's just almost impossible. We have a kid, have jobs, trying to make videos as well, and there are so much comments that, I mean, some of them don't make much sense. Some of them are just to make you feel bad. You always have those people that say you're dumb, you're stupid, you don't know how to do that. Okay, don't let people like that get to you, guys, because there is the other 90% of people that will be thankful that you did something. That's what we have, about 94-95% satisfaction on our channel, and the other ones don't like it. But hey, you always have people that are jealous, and like that guy right now said that he learned a lot from us, and we really appreciate it, because we learned a lot from you too, guys. All the comments, I might not reply to all of them, but I read them, and I listen to your advice about body paint, about taking things apart, everything. Because some of you might know better than us. I mean, some of you might have worked on a car for more than a few years, and you know how to do everything on it. And it's still new to us. A few models, not everything is, guys, exactly the same nowadays. Every car is different, every car requires different approach. German cars are one thing, Japanese cars are another thing, Americans. But the idea is to create, guys, like a once a week live session. Let me know what you think in the comments about that. If you're interested about just answering questions. And again, I've been thinking about creating that forum on our website, mechaniclifestyle.com, so you can ask questions there and we can kind of form a community and answer that questions as well. We're still building our website. You know, guys, we moved across the country, so it's been a little bit chaotic now, time consuming, and we're still setting things up, but things will be delivered. Things will be delivered. I got that Hyundai Elantra from Copart. You can check it out on World Mechanics, our second channel, guys. That we almost finished working on it, so that thing is ready. And everything's going pretty good right now. But if you decide, guys, to start a channel or something like that, just I've seen people. I don't want to mention names, but they started with a $3,000-$5,000 camera, and they're like, I started from scratch, you know. I was like, yeah, right, you know, you don't start with a $5,000 camera working on cars, that's one thing for sure. Maybe $200 at the most, $300, that's it. That would be my suggestions. If you have a GoPro phone, you can do that as well. We're here to help each other, guys. But I've been thinking, give me an idea about how to answer the questions, how you can ask the questions. Like to have a weekly live video and you can ask your questions there and answer them next week, because some of the questions will require a little bit of research. I do not know everything, that's for sure, but I'll try to help you as much as I can. And that's time consuming, guys. We're not charging anything, everything is free. We love working on cars. We've been doing that for over 10 years now almost. And I would love to help you, but just let me shoot me an idea how to do that. And what else you want to see on the channel? We have videos like this one right here. Okay, that's our bumper repair video. That's going crazy, getting crazy views, like 1.3 million views. We're helping people save on bumpers, and I had so much criticizing on that video and so much like at the same time. And the thing is, like, yes, we can go ahead and buy a $400 bumper, that's no problem. But we grew up in a place where you couldn't get parts. That's the problem. When you cannot get the parts, you have to somehow fix your broken thing. Because you cannot just get $400 out of your pocket and go buy it, even if you want to. Even if you want to pay $1,000, you still don't have access to that part. So that's something that I will share once in a while, how to fix things. Even though it might be easier to just go ahead and buy a new one. Like another video, crazy video that's getting views right now is how to replace front wheel bearing without a press. It's getting so many views and it's getting so many likes and so many dislikes at the same time. It's if you read the comments, read some of the comments and you'll see people are criticizing. Yes, we do have a press. We can do that. But we used to do it without a press back in the day. And it's something that we shared again, guys, how we used to do things. We repaired so many bumpers. A video will be published. Let me show you on the Fiesta right now. You've probably seen our Fiesta ST. Okay, right here. The bumper has been repaired on that thing. Okay, right here, it was a big crack. You can see the video. We have the videos on World Mechanics. It's been repaired, hasn't cracked yet, six months later. The bumper on this BMW, guys, that the ZHP, the convertible that we have as a toy, it was smashed on this side. You can check it out on World Mechanics as well, guys. It was bad, and what we actually did, we fixed it. Still holding, six, seven months later. Okay, and check it out. This has been almost a year for the rear bumper of the Fiesta, and what we did, we combined two bumpers, Mazda 3 bumper, front bumper, and Fiesta ST rear bumper. Because we just want it to be different, and we're still working on it. The idea is to have carbon fiber, but I'm still learning how to do that. Very soon, next week or so, we'll have a video how to fix that cracked bumper as well. Because I don't think it's worth it to spend $200-$300 on a cracked bumper like that when you can fix it for less than $20. I really don't think it's a good idea to waste your money, guys. I mean, better buy something else than just waste them. You always have the people that will say, that's a shitty job, that's not right, that's terrible. But don't be discouraged, guys. I mean, you took the time to learn something, you took the time to do it yourself. So sooner or later it will get better. It will turn into something better. But learning cars, it's not easy. That's one thing for sure. We're constantly reading all the time. We get on the forums about everything, almost everything, because sometimes I want to deliver the right video to you. I want to make sure that I know what I'm talking about before I shoot the video. So the idea is just to have a weekly session now, live video, to answer the questions, guys, that you may have. Like a guy asked me how to fix a Dodge Charger, it's not starting, like no crank. Well, first thing, let me start with the idea that you should never buy a car that I tell you it just needs a starter. That's a bad idea. It's never a starter, okay? Unless you know the person, unless it's your brother, cousin or something like that, don't believe them, okay? Because if they tell you it needs a starter, it's not a starter. We have the video on World Mechanics. A guy was told that he needed a starter, a Dodge Charger, and it was a flooded engine. Flooded engine, guys, which was terrible. I mean, he had water in the pistons, it was corroded, it was done. And he said all we needed is a charger, is a starter. So we we bought the car from him, and we pretty much gave him the same amount of money he paid, because we knew it would need a new engine, but we could make a little bit of money on it, about $500-$600. So we were happy with it at the time. Took the engine apart, it wasn't salvageable, so we bought a new engine for that thing, put a new engine. So if the car is not cranking, check oil, check water, okay, coolant, check the coolant, check the water, the oil, to make sure that you have no water and it's not milky. Another thing, check if the starter exists, and if it's your own vehicle that one day just doesn't want to start, you have a main fuse somewhere. That main fuse, guys, we have a... We demonstrated on a Fiat 500 video. If you jump start your car the wrong way, what happens? It's a very popular video, guys. You can check it out. And what happened, actually burned the fuse, the main fuse for the computer. And as a result, the car will not even click or anything. You just turn the key on and you will not start at all. So always start with the electrical stuff. Check fuses. That's a fuse could save you quite a bit of money, guys. You go to the dealer, sometimes they'll tell you just because of a fuse, $80, because they charge you just per hour, okay? And fuse diagrams, you can find them online, but what I've been thinking about is creating a page on our website, Mechanic Lifestyle, and share all the fuse diagrams there for every car that we worked on. And we're making videos as well. Like you can see on that Mercedes W211, the E-Class, we probably have about 30-40 fuse videos, and I know some of you will get tired of those, but it's for a good reason. Those are the videos that actually people need. Those are the videos that you'll be somewhere on the road and something will happen and you want to check the fuse, but you cannot get to it. Okay, you don't know which one it is, because Mercedes, BMW, they have million fuses. They're a little bit more complicated than other cars, but I love them, you know, like Mercedes, BMWs, I love them. I'm not that kind of guy that will hate certain car. I mean, I like every car in a single way. Every car is good for something. That Hyundai Elantra that we got, it's a good commuter car. It's nothing crazy about it, but it's pretty nice car. I like the BMWs a lot, but Mercedes, one thing about it is, if I maintain it, I like it. But usually they will sometimes give you a little bit of headaches, especially electrical problems. Okay, let me just read a few comments here that we got. Okay, and greetings from the Mercedes C430. When I brake, it tends to pull to the right. What might be wrong? Thank you for the good job you're doing. Okay, one thing about it is you want to make sure that you bleed your brakes right. You want to make sure that you bleed them good, you don't have any air in the system. Also, make sure you don't have any ABS related codes on Mercedes, because it could be the ABS pump sometimes. But usually, what happens if one tire pulls a little bit more than the other one is the one that it pulls to the right, it means it's braking a little bit more. When it's braking more, it pulls to the right. Okay, the left wheel means that it has a little bit of air in the system sometimes. So Bleed the system. If that doesn't fix the problem, check your discs, the rotors as well. When you replace the brake pads, you always have to turn the rotors or get new rotors, because they might be too shiny and that could cause a problem as well. You might even feel vibration braking at high speed. So check this thing out. And another guy, Jamie, great videos, learned quite a bit. Keep up the good work. How do you like the new location? Well, love it, guys. I mean, it's not easy to start from nothing again, because you have to move everything. We had to move 3 cars, a camper, and the whole household to a different location, which was about 1500 miles away. So it took us 3 days driving. It was my mom, my dad was driving a car, I was driving the camper, I was pulling a trailer behind it, and we were pulling another trailer. So it's not easy to start, but if you don't like your current location, you want to move, don't be afraid, guys. I mean, you know, we had a big shop where we were in Oklahoma. It was really convenient. At first, when we started making videos, we used to make them in our front yard. Then we built a shop in the house. We did it ourselves, out of 2x4s and some plywood. So that wasn't easy. Then we started our detailing business and car dealership we had for a while. So it was really convenient. We had everything that we needed there, but at the new locations we don't, but we just feel happier here. I mean, it's something that we want, something we like. Don't get me wrong, I mean, if you love the mountains, you love the mountains, you might like the flats. It just depends on where you grew up, but I grew up close to the ocean, so that's why I decided to move. Okay, 1 second, we have another one. I have a BMW E91 with bad auxiliary water pump. Does it do for repair? Okay, pump, does it do? Okay, trying to get the question now. Okay, bad auxiliary water pump, you want to replace those. Okay, BMW's system, okay, the cooling system is a very complicated system. It's one that usually fails on BMWs. I would say probably every 6 to 8 years, I would overhaul the cooling system on a BMW. Like we did with this one, ZHP, it's a 2005 model. When we got a new thermostat, new hoses, new water pump, everything new. Because you will find, get on Craigslist, and I guarantee you that you'll find an overheated BMW inline 6-cylinder engine. And I'll tell you why. This is because people usually ignore little problems. You have a very small leak, they'll ignore it. That will lead to something like a new engine that will cost you $2,000-$3,000 easy. Even if you do the job, an engine will be at least $2,000, $1,500 for a BMW 2005 up. So never ever ignore the little problems, guys. We bought an Audi. Funny story, Audi A4, guys, a B6. We have an old video somewhere on World Mechanics, and I bought it from a kid, and he was like, yeah, it overheated. And I was like, dude, it has zero compression, you know, how you did that? I mean, you've melted the engine pretty much. And he's like, he had a water leak, but, you know, I was in a hurry to go see my girlfriend, and I was on the highway, and I didn't care so much. So what I did is I just drove it until it quit. I was like, that water leak, okay, it was just a loose clamp on a water hose, I think. And that cost the guy a $6,000 Audi at the time. He sold it for $1,200 just because like that. Because, you know, Audis, you know why they invented them. There are two infinities in the world, the universe, and working on an Audi. That's what we joke about. We like them, but they always want some kind of work. And always just don't ignore the little things, that they lead to something big. So if it's a bad auxiliary water pump, replace it. It's not very expensive, it's easy to replace. Just make sure that you bleed your cooling system the right way, because if you don't, you overheat the car as well. Okay, let me get the other questions now quick. Okay, just bought a W211, just here to say thanks for the video, super helpful, thanks man, we really appreciate it. We took so much time. That W211 that we had, guys, we bought it with the intentions to flip it, but that's at the time that we decided to move to California. So everything was happening really fast. We didn't have time to fix it, so I was like, let's just shoot a few videos if we can help people, because Mercedes, one thing about Mercedes guys is and when it's like up to 6-7 years old, it's an excellent vehicle. You will probably not find you know, much better vehicle for than Mercedes and BMWs, but Mercedes is super nice. Like some people, you know, depending, like teenagers don't like them, but depending on the model, I'll probably drive one anytime. And when they start getting old, they'll give you electrical problems. That's one thing. Computers, modules, things like that will start going bad. And most of the things you can fix yourself. Or you can just get the software to program something if you need to, like a new module. Because it's not as complicated as they make it looks like. But the dealer will tell you, no, you cannot do that. Most of the things, you will be able to do them with a little bit of research. Like transmissions on like 2000 to 2007 models, they have the conductor plate in the transmission. That's a weak spot on those, and it's super easy to replace. It's like less than $100 for the part, so you can replace it yourself in, probably not to say a big word, but 2 to 3 hours, easy. And that will save you probably close to $1,500, unless you decide to waste your money and go somewhere to have that thing done. Okay, one quick question from another guy. Okay, that the stereo works but cannot get sound through the speaker deck and CDs, but FM stereo doesn't work. Any ideas? Okay, is that okay, that's on the Mercedes. That's a complicated thing. We have a video on a W163. Do some research. We have it on one of the channels. It has the optical, okay, the optical cable. And that optical cable, guys, is the one that transfer actually the voice. Okay, it transfers the voice of the CDs to the unit. Okay, and if somewhere it doesn't work, okay, what's happening, it's losing connection. The sound system on Mercedes is a little bit complicated, until you learn how it actually functions. When you learn how it functions, it's simple, but one thing about the optical cable is, like, you have to replace the whole cable. You cannot just splice it and cut it and weld and, you know, solder it. It doesn't work that way. So what I'll do, another thing is to check the amp, okay? I can get sound through the tape deck and see this, but FM stereo doesn't. Okay, so that's so the FM, does it make any noise at all? Like, do you get like static or something like that, or no noise at all? Let me know. And because another thing, the W211 is, we took the radio apart off actually today in a video. Static. Okay, that's that could be your antenna then. Because if you don't hear anything coming from the radio, it could be a fuse too. But if you get static, then check your antenna. I think there is a fuse for the antenna, but I'm not quite sure yet. I'll check and see if I can find more information about that. But usually a bad antenna will cause that. Okay, just found you guys a few weeks ago. Love your videos. I own a W211 and your videos are very helpful. Thank you, appreciate it. We made about 90 videos, I believe, on that W211, and the plan was to make probably close to 200. And I still have some that I haven't uploaded because we've been a little bit busy, but things will just fall into place, so we will upload them. But one thing about Mercedes, guys, is like, watch other Mercedes videos as well, because some models we use the same engine. Let's say that W211 E320, it was the same engine that we had in our Mercedes ML320, the C320 we had in E320, so SLK 320, they use the same engine, the same stuff. That's what I like about BMWs and Mercedes, because they're very, they use their stuff in more than one model. So when you learn one model, you know how to do a lot of things. But Mercedes, never ever let Mercedes stay with dead battery. And that's a good reason why, because a dead battery will cause malfunction in the computer modules. And we had a C320 that we it was a 2005 model C320 4MATIC. We let it sit with that battery for a couple of weeks. We started it and we got an ABS, an airbag message. I was so mad about it. The ABS, I reset it with the computer, but the airbag message, what I did, I connected the MaxiSys device. You can find out more information about that powerful tool on our channel. And when I did that, I connected, it told me that the airbag module, the computer, the VIN number didn't match the VIN number of the vehicle. I was like, how is that happening? You know, it hasn't been removed. It's been there. It hasn't been replaced. It's old factory. What happened when it got it didn't have power? What happened? Actually, it forgot one of the letters in the VIN number, and that was gonna cost us $2,000 at the dealership. We called, and there I was like, there is no way I'm paying that much money. So I did a little bit of research, and I found a guy on the internet on eBay. I'll try to find information about the store. He was fixing airbags from Kansas City. So what I did, I contacted him, the name looked like something Russian, and I contacted him and I explained to him the situation. He said, yes, no problem, send it to me. It was like 50, 60 bucks, and I'll program the new VIN number in it, because I couldn't. And the deal was amazing. He sent it to me next day. I plugged it in, everything worked fine, but at the dealer, that was gonna cost about $2,000. So always charge your batteries. If you store the car in the winter time, put it on a charger, because something like that could cost you quite a bit of money. And also, you can also put the car like BMW. We had that E65, the 745 Li. You can put it in a sleeping state, like to disconnect all the computers kind of thing, so nothing goes bad. But you have to have the computer for that, and not everybody does. So just keep it charged. Okay, let me read a few questions now. What do you think is an alternator with 14.8 15 volt charge voltage? Too much? Should I replace it? What kind of vehicle and what year is it? Because usually up to 15 wouldn't be too bad, to be honest with you, but if you start seeing 16, 17s, we have a video on mechanics. We had a Mercedes ML320 that was running 17, 18 volts. Okay, it's an E90 diesel. So you're probably, you can't tell for sure, but I think you're probably good to go there. Because if you go in the higher numbers, we had that Mercedes, you can cause some damage to the computers, to the modules, because too much current will burn a module easy. We didn't burn anything, we didn't set the car on fire, we replaced our alternator and that was fixed. But we caught it by accident. So what I would recommend is, like, we were doing an oil change and I decided to see, I decided to see what kind of voltage it's getting. So when I saw 17, 18s, I was about to pass out. And what happened actually is we didn't even drive the car at all. I was like, no, that's it. We need to get a new alternator, because you burn a module, that will cost you $500 to replace it, at least for a single one. So always for an oil change, when you change your oil, clean your air filter, whatever you do for maintenance every 3,000 to 5,000 miles, get a voltmeter, guys. They're free, they're really inexpensive. They're like $10 or something like that. And always check your voltage. It takes less than 30 seconds. One thing about it is, like, check the voltage when the car is warm, because when the car is cold, sometimes it might consume a little bit of energy, because especially the newer cars, they have the secondary air pump, which runs when the vehicle is cold, so it can warm up the catalytic converters for emissions faster. That consumes quite a bit of energy. Also, the car is idling higher. Usually you notice about 500 RPMs difference when the car is cold. And this is because the engine is still tight. It needs to get loose. And make sure that you reach optimal temperature of the engine, and then check your voltage. Okay, another one. When do you recommend to change the timing chain on the W211? That's a good question. The W211 is, some Mercedes have, well, depends which one you have, like the E320 or 350. Let me know which one you have, because the 320s, you probably should replace them at 100,000 to 120,000, to be honest with you. But we had MLs with that 3.2 engine, and we had more than 215,000 miles with not a single knock, good chain, everything was good. Okay, the 350, that's why I wanted to know. The 350, you can do some research about R350, that's the R-Class. They have a problem with the, not so much with the timing chain, but it's a sprocket balancer, I think it was called, that will go bad. And you can see so many with mechanical problems at the auctions. And probably I would recommend doing that at about 120,000 miles to maybe even 100,000 miles. It's quite a bit of a job, to be honest with you. We almost bought one to work on it. So I did quite a bit of research, but it was a long time ago, so I kind of lost it. But I would recommend to replace it, because that spark is actually sell an updated one. Okay, and that updated one is a little bit better, but the other one, the teeth will get wore out, and if the timing chain jumps, you're done. I mean, you need a new engine, and sometimes it's easier to put a new engine than putting a timing chain on those. But I'll recommend doing it if you know how to. Okay, my W211 E40 fuel pump. Okay, is have, okay, let me see, I'm trying to figure out here the question. Fuel pump click sound in the car off in the summer. Okay, I just couldn't get that question right. Please rephrase it, because my English is not perfect by any means. So just let me know, guys, again. But W211 E240, we don't have the E240 in United States, that's one thing, but they share many things like the E320 here. E240 is for the rest of the world. Here they import like 320, 350, the 505, and the AMG models. And I think that we have the CDI as well, the CDI here, but nothing smaller than a 320, I believe. And when you have guys like Mercedes, I told you always like, if you don't drive it, put it on a charger, because that could be a little bit of headache. And timing chains, more on timing chains, we have a video on World Mechanics Hyundai. If you have a Hyundai, you definitely want to replace the timing chain before it hits 100,000 miles, because at 118,000, 120,000, I've noticed many vehicles will have bad timing chains, and it will cost you pretty much a new engine. And we have a Hyundai Sonata video that we took apart. It had 155,000 miles, and the timing chain tensioner was bad on it. So we replaced that one. We have a video on what it looks like, what the problem is. Okay, we got another video right here. My headlamps are very dim. Okay, about every LED bulbs, if I'll recommend it. Are your headlights clear, like crystal clear, or they have that yellowish tint on them? Have you cleaned them? We have a video on the E320, how to clean them, but we have a video on the E320 for LED bulb, and unless you have the projectors inside, I wouldn't recommend it. If you have the projectors, you can install LED bulb, but I couldn't find one that fits good in that Mercedes. And unless you modify some things on the headlight, and I really don't want to mess with the factory headlights, because those could be expensive. You can buy a factory looking bulb, not LED. I think Osram and Sylvania makes those, like in super bright. They're a little bit expensive, but still probably cheaper than LED bulbs, and they work a little bit better with notice. So probably replace them with those. I'll try to get a link for that. Okay, let me see. When I turn off my car, the fuel pump have a sound like clicks. Okay, that I've never noticed anything like that before from the fuel pump having sound, but it could be a relay as well. Is it coming like from the area of the fuel tank? Because it really depends. It could be a relay. It could be quite a few things, but some models have a relay by the pump, and that could cause the problem as well. Greetings from South Africa. Love your show. Thanks. I really appreciate it, man. Hey, Vegas here. Hey, you comment quite a bit. Thanks. We got advice from you this morning, even on some painting stuff. We actually go through Vegas quite often, so if we head that way, I'll let you know. Do you work on cars and stuff? Do you fix that? I saw that your name is 3 Car Garage. Is that something that you work on all the time, or it's like a hobby? Let me know. But fuel pumps, usually, guys, you gotta make sure that everything's good there. Flip about 2 years. That's how we started. Everything started like that. I first bought like when I first came here. Hey, from Oklahoma, almost. Awesome, man, awesome. I spent 10 years there. Start having a few cars. I started flipping them not because I wanted to make a little bit of money, but because I'll get tired with the car. That's one thing. I'll keep it 6 months and I want something else. Then I'll drive it for 3-4 months and then all of a sudden I want something else. And that led to something that I actually, probably for every 10 cars, 9 out of 10, I made a little bit of money on them. So you always have to avoid being spontaneous buyer. Always, sometimes it's better to buy a car that you can fix something on it than just buy it fixed, because you can make money if you decide to resell it too. But you have to be careful what you get too, because sometimes the picture is hidden. People will try to get advantage of you. Okay, still the video running there, guys. That bumper repair. I had so many comments about that bumper repair that it will crack, it will be done. This bumper, guys, we sold that car with my dad. We sold it to a 70 something year old gentleman, really nice guy. He bought 2 cars from us, and this bumper looks amazing. I've seen it in person a few months ago. It was a year and a half since we fixed it, and the bumper still looked amazing. I was surprised by that. Mechanic stuff, like you say that you don't do mechanic stuff, you start a little at a time, okay? And don't get me wrong, you don't need any fancy tools. Like I've seen people wanting lifts and stuff like that. We had a car dealership, we were flipping probably about 50 cars a year, and we didn't have a lift. We used to do that, everything without a lift. Nowadays the cars, guys, are most of them engine comes from the front or up, or even just a cherry picker will help you do that. A cherry picker is like $100 and something, $200, really inexpensive cherry pickers, and you don't need so much tools. I'll share, I've been thinking about that and been doing that lately, share all the links for the parts and tools that we use, so that way you can see what we use, and if you need to get it, you don't spend so much time doing the research. But just start little. One thing at a time leads to another thing. Okay, thanks for your help. I have a 80 series to the Land Cruiser. Any videos for them would be much appreciated. One thing about it is, like, we live right now in California close to the mountains, and getting things like that, it's impossible. Let me tell you why. Because those things are expensive now. I mean, there is so much demand for the Land Cruisers, the old Land Cruisers, that we cannot get one. If I find one, I'll definitely buy it. If it's cheap, I'll definitely jump on it, because off-road vehicle like that, it's only going to increase in value. But it's hard to do that. Okay, I go near LA a couple times a year. Actually, we live right north of LA, so we're in LA probably almost every other day. I'm about 20 miles north, so hit me up when you head that way, man. We can meet sometime. Long Beach, yep, we go to Long Beach. Last time we went to Long Beach was for the racing there that they have at the harbor. It was really cool. But usually Long Beach is not far away from me. It's about 45, 50 minutes, something like that. So when you head that way, let me know.
What else?
Yeah, but those Land Cruisers, if I get one, I'll probably buy, but it's impossible. Like, there was one in town that needed so much stuff and it was junk and they wanted an amazing amount of money. I was like, no way that's happening. Hey, thanks, man. When we head to Vegas, I'll hit you up. Do you order motorcycle maintenance? Do you? Okay, well, let me show you. Talking about other motorcycles. Right there, guys. Oh, that was the computer. Okay, that right there is a 1978 Honda. I like the new stuff, but I like the old school too. Okay, look at that thing. That thing, we done the video that we purchased it. Well, actually, we did the video on this one. This one is an 1984 XL200R. And this one is XL250S. I got this one from another gentleman in town. And it had original 3,000 miles when I got that thing. Got it for close to 2,000, but I love the vintage stuff. So we'll shoot some videos. We probably won't have too much because it's, you know, it's something that doesn't break so often, to be honest with you. What we did the other day, yesterday actually, we put a brand new seat on that thing. Check it out. That seat, I got it online. It was very, very inexpensive, the seat cover. That was the old one. When I bought it from the gentleman, the seat was in perfect condition, but the leather turned into plastic. And what happened, it just starts cracking. And when it cracks, you don't want to mess up the foam in the seat. Because if you drive it that way, you have a chunk of foam missing, and later when you install a new cover, that will be visible. So if you want to see how to redo a seat on a motorcycle or an armrest, we even have a video about the armrest on a BMW. Like this one, we'll be replacing it. Okay, you can see this one, you can make them like new. They sell the covers, so you don't have to buy the whole armrest, because the whole armrests for cars are expensive, but you can do them yourself. And a video that will be coming, guys, very soon, is how to cover your seats. Okay, look at that Beamer now. It's all factory, 330 CI ZHP, the package thing. But the seat, it was in Texas vehicle. So you can see the seat has cracks. So we'll have a video this winter, that will be our project, guys. How to fix those cracks. How to make the seat look like new. And we'll be changing the color of the seat. We're thinking about going brown leather or red leather on it. So we will have a video how to change the whole cover of the interior of the video, and it will look really professional. We did a little bit of work, so I will definitely have that in mind. But okay, any new videos on BMW 65 E66? For right now, I have a few more to upload that I showed. Hey, I need to still upload those, but one thing about it, guys, is the E65, that's probably one of the most comfortable cars that I've ever known. And ours is a C66, it was the 745 Li. Those sometimes need work, and a few things go bad on them, but people will ignore them and lead to something big. And we sold ours. I sold it here in California. We bought it here and I sold it because I just couldn't maintain so many cars. And it's, you know, everything has to be registered here. You have a certain amount of time running low on money. So we sold the E65, but I've been thinking about getting a new one. And the other day I actually found one, a B7 Alpina. And we'll see if I can put my hands on that thing, but still quite a bit of money. They wanted 5,000 at an auction for it. It needs a little bit of work, but being Alpina, it makes it a little bit more expensive. So videos might come soon. BMWs and Mercedes, you'll definitely see more on the channel. I definitely get more. Okay, and driving an Africa Twin 1987 myself. Oh man, that's cool. Thank you for showing me how to change the PCM. In Charger Magnum. No problem, no problem. If you ever need any if you have any questions, we have quite a few videos on that Charger Magnum that works. It's really easy to work on those things. Not my favorite, to be honest with you, but they're super easy to work on for electrical stuff. They're not complicated. Why California, if you don't mind me asking? Something about that place, I don't know. I love the ocean, that's one thing, so love surfing, swimming, and grew up by the ocean, so that's the reason why we picked here. And visited here in 2015, first time I came, and I said one day we'll probably come. We came again 2016, and here it comes, it happened. Older is 8. Okay, I didn't get this thing, I'm sorry. okay, let me see now that thing. Any videos on how to clean dirty leather? We actually do, guys. We actually do have a video, okay? And let me... we have it on World Mechanics. Okay, let me find it quick. Let me just open the computer quick or the phone. Right here on the other phone, I'm going to switch to it quick, okay? And on World Mechanics, I wanna show you. We have a video how we clean a dirty seat on a Hyundai Sonata. I've never seen a dirty seat like that. And just check it out, guys. It's on our second channel, World Mechanics. We put a few things there as well. And let me just open the video so you can see the thumbnail, okay? One second now. Where'd it go? We uploaded quite a few videos since then. Okay, this is now... One second. Play. Okay, check it out now. This is the video, guys. I'm gonna show you in one second how dirty that seat was. Okay, and we're gonna go towards the end. I'm showing you how actually nice it looked after that. Okay, that's one nasty seat. When it's fixed, I'm gonna go back to it and show you. Okay, that's a thumbnail. Okay, right here for the seat. Okay, you can see the difference yourself, guys. Clean and not cleaned. And let me see now a few questions that we have here. Okay, why? thank you very much, brother. You helped me a lot. Yeah, no problem, man. Thanks for being appreciative. E500 2003. Okay, what about it? Let me know about that. E500. Which cars do you own now? Okay, we'll get to that in a second. What part of California, friend? North of LA, guys. Right north of Los Angeles. Great guy, greetings from Germany. Hey, thanks, man. We have family there, actually. My dad's brother, he's living in Berlin right now. So I've been there. I was there right before I came to the United States. Love that place. I was to Austria, Germany. It was really fun. Okay, and let me switch to the video quick. Okay, look at that nasty phone where we were cleaning the seat. Okay, that was just something else. Visiting Germany is on my bucket list. Man, you won't regret it. That you have quite a bit of fun. And if you like beer, you're gonna love that place. Do you know if headlights from a E350 be installed on a 2008? You guys help a lot with my WTO3. Thank you so much, brother. Say no problem, man. Anytime. We really appreciate it, okay? The headlights now. Let's go back to it. Do you have the part numbers? Always compare part numbers. If you gotta make sure that... it's the same part number or the same style of headlight, because some of them, they have the self-leveling, they have the xenon, they have all kind of stuff, so you have to make sure it's the same headlight. It's hard to tell you, but always check the part number. It's usually on the back of the headlight, but most likely check the plugs, the wires, and if you have the same wires, probably it's the same headlight as well. Okay, so that shouldn't be too complicated. Those WTO3s, we wish we had more videos for those. Really, We sold it way too quick because we were too busy. We were making a living too. We were working, both of us guys, fixing cars, trying to flip something, and we always worked for a little bit of profit, so not so much. And I couldn't work with customers too much, to be honest with you, because I couldn't ask for $60-$80 an hour. When we were working, we were asking like $15 an hour. Dan and I, we were making minimum wage. But I have another guy come and ask me to do something. I cannot rip him off, guys. I'm not that guy. And that's why I almost got out of that business. And that's why I decided to just go into something else, make videos and do online things. And as you know, everything is pretty much following from there. But hey, check out the seat now. Okay, we're about to remove the tape so you can see the about. It's very important to clean your leather, guys. If you don't, okay, you will regret it later, because you're going to resell your car and it will be worth nothing, because every car I sold, I'll clean it, detail it real nice. We have more detailing videos, but when I clean it, they get in the vehicle, they jump in it, and they're like, wow, that smells good, that's one clean car, it must be maintained good. That's the first idea you get. If the car is clean, people think it was maintained good. Not always the right thing, but probably it is. Okay, check out the seat now. Yep, let's pull. You can see how soft it makes the leather as well, compared to what it was here. Okay, that was nasty seat. Okay, so we'll pull the tape on it and see the difference right there, guys. So if you think you have clean seats, and probably summertime, I'll recommend cleaning your seats and applying conditioner with vitamin E. You can check out our cleaning videos. I'll share the links for what we use, because otherwise you end up with something like that. Beautiful car with bad leather. Okay, check it out. It shouldn't be like that. If you clean your seats, you avoid something like that. Okay, we got a few more questions. Let's see what is next now. My acceleration position sensor. Okay, that's... we don't have a video on that. But it's not too complicated, to be honest with you. And on the W203, I don't think it even needs to be programmed. I think you just get a part and swap it. But do a little bit of research, because I haven't done it on that W203 myself. So just do a little bit of research. I'll see if I find something. I'll share it on that video in the comments later, so you can see it yourself. But usually the gas pedal is really easy to replace. You just a few nuts, bolts, and that's it. Okay, what cars do you own? Okay, let me show you guys. All right, that's the Hyundai Elantra that we fixed. We own, as of right now, the BMW. Okay, that BMW, I haven't driven it since we moved here, because right now things are a little bit complicated. You know, you don't always have the resources you want to, and plus we have the baby, so all of us don't fit in a car with my parents. So when we go places, we usually drive one of those. You see us, guys, in the Fiesta ST, four people and a baby packed in that thing going down the road. Yep, it's small, but it's fun, it's practical. We have that the family van right here, guys. That Toyota Sienna that we fixed, we got from Copart. And this is the Hyundai, but one of them will go now. That Hyundai, we will be making a few videos on that as well. We got it from Copart, guys. We have it on World Mechanics, our second channel. Okay, what we did with that thing, how we purchased from Copart. And since we don't have the trailers anymore, and we purchased this one from Portland, Oregon, and they delivered it to our house almost from Copart. It cost a little bit of money, but I think it was worth it. And one of those two will need to go, because cannot afford it right now. We will have a video, if you guys in California, how to register a salvage car, because it's quite a bit of experience when you move to a new state. Everything is different, everything is new, every paperwork needs to be researched, and especially smoke test, brake and lamp test, and things like that. Okay, let's see if we got anything else. Are you on Instagram? Yes. Auto repair guys. We just made one. So find me, man, and we'll follow each other. But and I have World Mechanic Instagram as well, but Auto Repair guys will be the one that will see most of the new things. On World Mechanics, you can check out some of the past projects. We need to work on that thing next, on that BMW, because it's leaking oil from the valve cover gasket. So we'll have some common videos, guys, about valve covers. Okay, look at that, it's leaking. So we have the box underneath it, so we don't get the shop dirty. But that's one thing about it. So we still have to work on many things, but everything just moving, and the baby, and everything is happening fast, guys. Everything is involving money, everything's involving time. So one at a time. You got any bad experience with Copart? If you're on Copart long enough, you get bad experience. We had a few cars that we actually took. We didn't even bring them home. What we did, we bought them. We won them at the auction. We went to pick them up. It was so bad. It was so bad that we just, the moment they took it out of the yard, we went inside the office and we said we want to resell that thing. We had the dealer license, so we could do that easy. But Copart, always go check your vehicle before you bid, the day before the bidding. I'll tell you why, because we had cars that you go look at it and 2 weeks later the auction will be for that car. But people that go check it out, sometimes they'll steal something out of the car. You've seen people stealing radio buttons, stealing all kind of stuff, stealing keys. It says that he has keys now for the run and drive. They keep the keys inside. This is an amazing thing that they did. So you know that you'll get a key. But always guys, go check it out the day before the auction, because you can get a really good deal, but also you can regret it. 8 out of 10 cars, we get a good deal. The other two, not. A video is coming soon, how to bid on Copart, guys. The video is actually shot and is uploaded, but it's scheduled for a future date, because I have quite a few videos still to post for the Mercedes and other things as well. Okay, let me check what else we got now. Any car, ever bought any car from IAAI? I did, and they're pretty good, used to be pretty good. I bought cars from them probably about 4 years ago. A few cars, we bought a Mustang. It was still pretty new back in the day, like a 2005 Mustang. We bought a Ford Focus, something else, and we had good experience with them, but they have a fee for bidding. They had like I don't remember what it was at the time, like the fee for the membership for 1 year, and I just didn't feel like I want to pay that fee, to be honest with you. That's why I switched to Copart. Copart, as of right now, they have so many cars. They have like $180,000 if you go on the website. So they have quite a few, but always go check them in and look at the car, because it might be flooded, might have a wet interior that later you get mold. That's some of the stories we've heard. Always check for hail damage, because sometimes, and they're busy, I don't blame them, but sometimes it's hard to get in the picture hail damage, and we have that in the video as well. So always gotta make sure that you go see it yourself before you place the bid. Okay guys, and check out the bicycle. Okay, that's that thing. I was so happy to find that thing found that one on Copart, guys, and another bike on Copart, and I got it for a great deal. Okay, this thing on Copart, we ended up paying $180, and this was a $1,650 bicycle back in 2006, I believe. And we bought another bike as well from Copart. So sometimes you'll find bikes, sometimes you'll find random things, so you'll always be able to find something. Do you think that trees are good cars in your opinion? I'm thinking of buying a new one. You mean well, WTO3, what kind of year you're thinking about it? Let me know what year and exactly which engine. Is it like a C320, C230? Because we own a few of those. I have been buying mine from Craigslist. Last one I bought was an old one, and I paid $450 total invested was. Okay, that's a way to go. That's how everything started, guys. So I came here and I didn't know about Craigslist. A friend of mine accidentally introduced me to Craigslist, and Dad and I, we started buying cars for ourselves. We bought so many Ford Focuses in 2009 and 2010. When they first came out, like the ZX3 and things like that, we even bought an SVT one time. And we'll get them on Craigslist for like $300-$500. It was cheap deal, like needing an engine or transmission, clutch, something. Then we got a Hyundai Tiburon. We got a few of those. We flipped probably more than 10 Focuses. Craigslist was going really good, but lately I cannot get anything good on Craigslist for a trashy car that won the same amount of money that if it's fixed. So that's why I started doing some auctions. In Oklahoma, I still could find good things on Craigslist, and I looked the one in Vegas. I can find a few things, but it's just a little bit far away for me. In LA, it's practically impossible to find something that you can make $1,000 on it. So it really depends on where you live. Okay, that C240, 2002, that's, okay, don't get me wrong, it's a little bit older car. If it's maintained right, it's good. One thing that we'll probably need to replace is the screen on the cluster. We have it on World Mechanics, one of the first videos shot with an iPhone 3GS. The LCD display was dim, that's one thing that you need to replace. But test everything that it works, get a scanner with you. And one thing about it is, like, you want to make sure that the transmission is fine. Drive the car like about 25 miles per hour in automatic mode, and then just jump on it like all the way to the floor, okay, so it can kick in first gear. If the transmission is bad, it's gonna get stuck in limp mode. That's what we experienced with some WT03. So check that. Check for leaks. Valve cover gaskets sometimes have leaks. What else to check? How many miles on it? Let me know how many miles on that thing as well. Copart and IAA. Well, really, eBay. eBay, you'll be able to find dealers that will get good deals sometimes from auctions, dealer auctions, and they'll flip them on eBay. Like, there is a guy in LA, I think he lists like 120 cars, something like that. But I cannot find a good enough deal for me. So pretty much those are the ones that we use. Okay, Vegas Craigslist has some good deals. Yeah, I know, man. If you're a mechanic, you can find great deals. Probably we'll see you one of these days. If we flip the Fiesta or the Hyundai, we'll probably head that way for something. 160,000 miles on the Mercedes. Could be good, could be bad. Usually they'll go easy over 200,000 miles with the right maintenance. One thing about it is, like, check for engine light, because the catalytic converters might have problems. And especially if you live in a state that you have to do the smoke test, the exhaust system, you gotta make sure you get a scanner with you. I have one, I'll mention that in the next video. I need to do the research. I'll find it somewhere. I have it in a box. A scanner that you can check when was the last time the engine light was reset. Because they might have reset it just the day you bought it, that morning. Okay, and you have an engine light later. So if you know the people, that will help a little bit, to be honest with you. But always check for leak, check transmission problems, codes. And make sure all the electronic works. If you have a sunroof, that's a weak spot, and you have to lubricate the sunroof. We'll have a video on that as well coming soon. So check that thing out, guys. Okay. What else? Okay, I'm trying to see. Okay, other sites that I found actually the other day I've been looking at is somebody asked me if I know other things. Is I found some good deals on Letgo and OfferUp, but cannot afford to buy anything as of right now. Next week I'm gonna introduce you to those and how to find a good deal. Probably will make a video, but always check online, guys. And around Christmas is when you buy a good car. And let me tell you why, because people need money. Christmas is a very, you know, everybody spends money on gifts and stuff. So as a result, people will sell their spare cars for nothing sometimes. We bought cars for $200-$300 around Christmas, feeling bad even doing that. I even paid more than asking price for a Hyundai because the dad didn't have money for to buy gifts for the kids, and I paid him $200 more. I just felt bad for him. Buy now, sell tax season. That's it. You got that thing right, man. That's why we tax season is like once February hits until April, that's when you expect to sell a car. That's why we have this one ready here. We have the Hyundai ready. So almost ready. We have to fix the phone bumper. We have the video on that thing. You can see. I think this one was caused call part. I cannot guarantee you it was, but it looks like it was the fork that went in. We'll fix that thing. This one, I'll put the Fiesta for sale, guys. I found the cheapest SD in LA at about 12, and I'll probably ask only 10 for that thing. Still need to do a little bit of work to the rear bumper to make it look decent. Okay, let's see what else now. Is replacing part easier than rebuild? Okay, let me know what you talk about. Let me know about exactly which part, okay, you want to replace, then rebuild. Like front bumpers, or let me know and I'll get more info on that. Do I use plastic welder? They're awesome. I've used it in the past. It works for some plastic, for me it did, for some it didn't. Really thought about getting one, to be honest with you, and probably will. But that will come soon. Probably I'll get one. But the zip ties and the epoxy on bumpers and stuff works really good. And about my phone is about to die, guys. The phone and the computer itself. That's the first live session over an hour, and I just don't have everything ready. Still warning, guys. So bear with us. Next, what do you think about next Saturday doing like a video? Maybe something like how to prepare your car for the winter, what you need to know, or how to avoid costly repairs because of the winter and things like that, what to look for and how to service your car. Let me know. And probably Saturday about the same time to do one more session. So let me know what you think about that. Thanks for the videos and going live. Have a good day, and let me know if you come to Vegas. Thanks, really appreciate it, and we definitely do. Next time we're there, we'll definitely stop by. Thank you for watching us, guys, and when you have an idea, just share it in the comments, okay? It means a lot. We're learning from one another. I don't know everything, and neither does, but that's how we learn. Building a car community, I think it will be very helpful. Thank you, guys, and bye from us. See you next time. Okay, to see how to end that thing now. Still warning, guys. Okay. Still. Okay, I think my phone just froze, so if you. Okay, you might get an idea. Anyone has an idea how to turn the live stream off? I need input about that now. Are you sure you want to stop live streaming? Okay, see you guys next time.